faculty of the District of Columbia's College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences. Welcome to Causes. The University of the District of Columbia is the only public university in the District of Columbia and the only exclusively urban land-grant university in the United States. In the proud tradition of the land-grant universities, the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences serves a dual mission. We offer academic programs on our campuses, and we offer community outreach programs in all 8 wards of the District of Columbia. With me today on Causes TV is Chef Herbert Holden. Chef Herb works in our Center for Nutrition, Diet and Health, one of our land-grant centers, and he teaches us how to eat healthy and to do so on a budget.
Yes.
Welcome, Chef Herb.
Thank you.
So why is it so important to cook from scratch? Because many of us don't do much of that anymore, right? We buy highly processed, packaged foods. So you're trying to reverse that trend.
Exactly.
And get people back to cooking from scratch. Why is that such an important mission?
Well, the importance of what I'm doing and why we should get into the kitchen and start back cooking is because, you know, it's about nutrient-dense foods.
Uh-huh.
It's about changing our eating patterns. It's about being healthy. And one way is cooking. You know what's in your food. You know what you're putting in. It's not processed. So mm-hmm. by getting in the kitchen and preparing fresh fruits and vegetables, you know what's in your foods.
Okay, so you have prepared all kinds of fresh ingredients, raw.
Mm-hmm.
So what are we doing? What are we cooking?
Well, today I'm going to be preparing asparagus soup.
Ah.
And the reason I chose asparagus is I like to focus on seasonal fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
Reason being, because I do the SNAP Ed, the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, is we want folks that are on a limited budget to eat healthy. And uh-huh. one way to eat healthy is by buying in season. And right now, your asparagus is in season. And so the cost is down because
okay.
it's in season right now.
So if I watch what's growing
mm-hmm.
in this region, in the Mid-Atlantic region, then I can actually lower the cost of making things from scratch by buying the foods that are plentiful right
yes,
now.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And then we can, you know, I can show you how to preserve everything that you've brought in season, you know, market season is about to start off. So January, February, March, there's nothing fresh. But you took advantage of your market season
mm-hmm.
and brought the seasonal fruits and vegetables, and I showed you how you preserve to lock in the nutrients so you can eat healthy during the
okay.
wintertime just by going to the freezer.
When you say market season, you mean farmers?
Farmers
markets,
yes, exactly.
Okay.
So, you know, we encourage residents to get out and visit your local farmers markets, and, you know, and not just in your neighborhoods. I encourage you to try other farmers markets in other
mm-hmm.
neighborhoods because mm-hmm. of the different cultures we have.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see more fruits and vegetables from their culture versus this culture in this area. So, you know, I get people out of the box, you know, try something you have never tried before, and I was show you how to prepare that
okay.
particular item.
So tell us some of those secrets. I mean, we run a farmer's market here,
mm-hmm.
Right on Connecticut Avenue
yes.
in front of the university. One of the ones I like is Columbia Heights,
mm-hmm.
a very Hispanic kind
yes.
of market.
Yes.
A lot of different assortments. What are some of the other more ethnic markets that you like?
Well, I particularly love the one you named because of the, you know, the cactus leaves that I can get there,
yes.
the yellow watermelons. But then I go across to Ward 8 and you get more of your traditional foods that you normally
mm.
see, your mainly your fresh greens, your kale, your collard greens. And so I kind of like to float around the city
okay.
just to try the different, you know, fruits and vegetables from the different cultures as well. Even there are some ethnic markets as well
mm-hmm.
that you can actually purchase some African crops as well.
Ah.
Mm-hmm.
And we are back into that too. We're big in ethnic crops,
yes,
right?
Yes,
crops
we are.
That are not native to the Americas.
Exactly.
And of course, we have very diverse neighborhoods
yes,
here in the district with people from all over the world.
Yes,
so that's
we do.
Kind of fun. So where do we start making asparagus soup? Where do we start here?
Well, this is a very simple recipe
okay.
that easy to prepare, and you know, I get a question, you know, why do I do a lot of soups? As an introduction, and soups are an easy introduction, even for the 2 to 5 year olds that we serve, mm-hmm. plus the adults that we serve in the other communities, is you will try a soup versus if I steam this or if I grill this and you see it, you'd be like, you know what, chef, I don't think I want to try that. I had it and I didn't like it. But if I fix it in the soup form, you're more likely to at least have a taste. And uh-huh. once you taste it, you'd be like, wow, okay, this wasn't bad as I thought it was.
Uh-huh.
So soups are a really good introduction, you know, when you work with young kids as well, is talking about trying to stimulate their palates. So so that's why I focus on a lot of soups. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't have a lot of time to be in the kitchen cooking. Soups are one of the things that you can find the minimum amount of time to prepare large batches and freeze. So now you don't have to be in the kitchen all day. You can just package it up how you're going to eat
this. You just told everybody my trick. when I was raising 3 boys at home, I cooked a lot of soups,
yes.
a lot of stews, and that's exactly what I did. I would cook on Saturday or mm-hmm. Sunday and then put it in the freezer and take it out as we needed
right.
it.
Right, so there's yeah. no excuse now.
Yeah.
So when you come home, you can just if you've got a family of 5, just take out the 5 bags out the freezer and just drop them in a pile of boiling water, mm-hmm. and it's going to heat it up for you, mm-hmm. and you serve it in a bowl, and voila.
There you go. All right, so you have some interesting looking stuff here. So this is the broth, right?
Yes, this
That's
is
where
this
we
is,
start.
Right, this is a chicken broth.
Okay.
And you know, it's your choice, chicken broth or vegetable broth, mm-hmm. if you want to keep it strictly vegan. Of course, the asparagus. I have leeks here and fresh thyme. Also have shallots and some garlic that I have chopped up. And
it already smells good.
And to top it off, we have some microgreens here that I actually went up on our rooftop garden,
yes.
and got those out of our hydroponics house.
We grow them here.
Yes, we do.
So what's the thing? You know, you hear a lot about it now.
The
microgreens.
Yes.
Why are they so big now in nutrition circles and cooking circles?
Well, the microgreens are basically the first 2 set of leaves of whatever that particular vegetable that are growing. And
do you want to pick one up for
yes,
us?
Yes, the as you can see, you get the first 2 set of leaves. These
uh-huh.
are more nutrient dense than actually, if these was the carrot tops, more nutrition than the carrot bottoms itself.
Uh-huh.
So these are highly nutrient dense tops right now.
Okay.
And you can eat them in assortment of ways. You can salads, you can make them in wraps if you want to. You can just little olive oil on as I like mm-hmm. them and just eat them like they are. And as I'm gonna do today, we're just gonna cap the top of the soup off
okay.
with this. Then just enhances the flavors. They're also full of flavor as well.
Okay.
So we're gonna get started here.
Uh-huh.
What I have to start off is a little bit of olive oil here in my pot here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when we're working with asparagus, you know, I get a lot of questions about why is it so stringy?
Yeah.
You know, and I have to show you how to work with asparagus. Asparagus has its own natural snap point. So if you take asparagus, you bend it, the top part is normally the more tender part.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom half is where it's a little tougher. So if you're going to grill this
mm-hmm.
or steam this, it's best to take a carrot peel and just get that little outer layer from around, and you won't have to worry about the stringiness.
Okay.
But as we're doing soup today, we're not going to worry about that because we're going to blend up everything today in our soup. So
okay.
we're going to get started right now with olive oil first thing, and I'm going to add my shallots and some garlic to this.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to go ahead and put in my fresh thyme. So what I'm doing, we're just gonna saute this around and we wanna fuse these flavors together.
Mm-hmm.
And that is just combining the flavors, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have my asparagus and I have my leeks already cut up and
yep.
chopped up.
Yep.
Now leeks it's very important that we wash our leeks thoroughly. They grow completely out the ground
yep.
and the leaves traps in dirt.
Okay.
So you have to make sure you wash, you sterile. You don't want no grit in your food.
Yeah, okay.
So the best ways to do is just slice off the root end. Mm-hmm. The greens, the tops can be a little bitter. So, you know, I would just chop this, not just a little bit of greens towards the bottom of the stalk.
Okay.
And I will cut this in half and split it in half and wash each leaf under cool running water. That gets all the grit out of it.
Okay.
So that's very important that we wash our leeks to get all the dirt out. Mm-hmm. So now we are fusing these flavors together. So now I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna add my chopped leeks and my chopped asparagus to our pot here. And too bad we don't have smell-o-vision right now,
yeah,
because
it's
the combination of the shallots and the garlic alone, this aroma is unbelievable.
Makes me hungry. Really good.
So we're just gonna fuse those flavors together. You can have a good pot of soup if you just dump the vegetables in the pot and cover it with stock. But you have an even better soup if you fuse these flavors together first.
Okay.
Let them blend together, let them get them a chance to meet each other, as I like to say.
Mm-hmm.
And we just sauteed this around for a couple of minutes until the flavors start to fuse together. It breaks down of the vegetables so they can kind of meet each other.
A little softer, yeah.
And once we're satisfied that the fusing is okay, then we're gonna add some stock to this.
Okay.
Now let's talk about the stock.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's important that we understand what is the stock and what is the base. In the stores, your local stores, you go to the aisle where your stocks are and you see the box and it says this is, you know, chicken stock, this is chicken base.
Mm-hmm.
And if you pick the box it up and you shake it, you can hear that liquid in there.
Okay.
So the liquid tells me that it is a base. And the base is, you take the meat parts, we're gonna talk about chicken right now, you take the meat parts of the chicken along with your onions and your carrot and celery and whatever fresh herbs you want, you're just gonna boil that off.
Okay.
You're gonna strain it and the liquid becomes, is your broth.
Okay.
Now.
So if I do that, how long do I have to cook that chicken?
Well, it's your choice however long you want to cook to release all the flavors out of it.
Okay.
But, you know, with that, the chicken is gonna be part of your soup or what have you, because you have the meat parts in there.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're gonna talk about making a stock. And your
stock
is congealed, as you can see what I have right here.
Oh, yeah.
And the difference is, you got the bones now from the chicken.
Ah.
And you're gonna put that in your water with your onions and your carrots and your celery and whatever herbs you want. And once that boils down, the marrow comes out of the bone. And the marrow makes it congeal. Once you strain it and you cool it down, you have a layer of fat, you discard that layer of fat, and what's under there is your rich stock, congealed stock.
I see.
And what happens, the marrow that's in the bones in your stock actually help your immune system fight off certain colds.
Oh.
When we was younger, your grandmother fixed your chicken soup because it would help you with your colds.
So that's
the marrow that would come out of those bones. So now I'm happy with the fusing
when I buy that stock, it shouldn't be liquid, right?
I shouldn't hear it. Unless you want that base, that's right,
okay,
exactly.
So the base is the liquid and the stock is like a gel.
It's like a gel.
Okay.
And it's easy to make them yourself. You know what's in there. You're controlling the sodium in there. You're controlling everything by making your own stocks.
Okay.
You know, if you must buy from the store, some people are unable to, you know, hold knives or, you know, for different health reasons or what have you. You may have arthritis and, you know, I can't do all that chopping.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy no sodium and low sodium as well.
Okay.
But it's important that, you know, if you can make them yourself, you can make them. They're easily freezable. So you can freeze them. You can do it ahead of time, just like making the soups ahead of time.
Yep.
So I just added my stock to this. And when we're making our soups, we always want to make it too thick at the beginning instead of too thin, because you run in trouble trying to thicken it up if you make it too thin,
healthy
wise.
Okay.
So you have to make roux and butters. Be careful on the liquid, that's right. So now we have that in, we're just gonna let this steam down. And it doesn't take long. Once the vegetables are soft, then we're gonna take a immersible blender. We're just gonna blend this up.
Okay.
And once we blend it, we readjust our seasons. and we're ready to eat.
So in this case, really the stringy part of the asparagus doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter, right? Because we're going to blend it up. We're going to blend it, and you're not even going to notice it.
Okay.
And one of the good things about this particular soup, once you taste the soup, you're eating it as a soup, but it can be transformed into a sauce.
Ah.
So, you know, it's about getting the nutrients where they need to be, which is here.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you have to fool people. Sometimes, you know, I didn't make a soup. I made a sauce for some rice, for some pasta, for that chicken, or for that piece of fish.
Oh.
So once you get them to taste it, like, wow, that soup was good. What soup are you talking about? That sauce that you had was actually the asparagus soup. So, you know, we have to, you know, trick people sometimes just to get them
exactly, yeah, get them to try it.
And once they taste it, they were like, wow, this is really good.
So talk a little bit more about the asparagus. So when you use it for a soup like this, mm-hmm. where you blend it, then you can really use the whole thing.
You can use the
right?
whole thing, exactly.
If
exactly.
I steam it, I'm gonna have to do your...
Well, if you steam it, you know, you don't have to, it just has that snap point. That snap point just tells you the tender part from the tough part.
Okay.
But you can keep it whole and just take a carrot peeler, and like you said, you just can, you know, just middle way down and just peel that one outer layer,
uh-huh.
and you're not gonna have to worry about dealing with the stringiness of it.
Okay.
But if
okay.
you're making soups, like I said, you know, once again, we're grinding up everything, so you're not gonna taste it as
so
well.
So my grandmother used to say that asparagus cleans your blood. Is that true?
Well, it has a lot of health benefits. It has a lot of vitamin A, vitamin C, it has vitamin K, it mm-hmm. has good folic acid in it as well. And I've also learned that it also helps regulate your insulin levels in your body as well.
Really?
Yes.
Okay, so if I tend to have like fluctuating blood sugar, I should eat a lot of asparagus?
You can eat a lot of asparagus.
Wow, okay.
And you should be okay.
All right. And it doesn't really matter in which form?
No, it doesn't matter which form. Well, it does, but it doesn't. Now, when you're talking about steaming or sautéing asparagus, even grilling, you have to really be careful. The cooking process could actually kill a lot of the nutrients because uh-huh. we have the tendency of overcooking our vegetables.
Uh-huh.
And so we have to be careful with that. So soups is a great way because we're not throwing anything out.
Yeah.
Everything is
yeah.
staying into the pot, the liquid, everything is going to be consumed. So soups are the best way to keep all your nutrients in versus mm-hmm. I'm going to, you know, I use broccoli as an example all the time. People overcook broccoli.
Yeah.
It's pretty green when it starts out, and when they get done with it, it's a grayish color. So, and you know, and by adding those vegetables to water, it's just a matter of time for the nutrients to leach out.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we want to eat our colors, and that's what we stress. If it's green, it should be green on your plate when it's time to eat. If it's red, it should be red. That's telling me that the nutrients are still in those particular
okay.
vegetables.
So when I, let's say I'll steam this,
mm-hmm.
right? So I would take a pot of water.
Mm-hmm.
I have like an insert in
yes.
my pot. Is that the best way to do it?
As long as your insert is not touching the water. You don't want
okay.
it submerging in the water. And the best to do, say we're going to steam this. I like to use, instead of water, I like to use stocks,
okay.
Bases.
Oh, that
for,
gives you a flavor
it
already.
Gives it more flavor.
Uh-huh.
And get it nice and hot, pretty much like you see this pot rolling
yep.
right now.
Right.
And your colander or your steam basket will set over top of the pot, but
mm-hmm.
it's not going to be setting in the water.
Okay.
So you can add your vegetables once it's rolling, boiling, and put a lid on it. That'll keep that steam in, and it'll help it steam from the bottom and the top. And then you can lightly season it, and you're ready to go.
So for how long?
Well, for asparagus, I wouldn't, this no more than 3 minutes.
Really?
We'll be just fine. And
oh boy,
because
I've been oversteaming mine, I can tell you that.
It'll get mushy on you, and
yeah,
you don't want that. You want it, you know, when you want asparagus nice and firm,
a little
yeah, crunchy.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that's telling me that the nutrients are still there
mm-hmm.
and it's not being overcooked.
So you do the same thing like with broccoli, green beans,
exactly.
All
your vegetables you can steam the same exact way.
Uh-huh.
And like I said, we don't want to overcook them. Now, if you're going to submerge them in liquid, it's okay, but just remember, we don't want to do it no more than 4 minutes
okay.
because the nutrients are going to start to leach out and you're not going to have any nutrients in your vegetable. Everything is going to be in the liquid.
Yeah, and then usually we throw the liquid away.
We throw the liquid away, exactly.
You know what my grandmother used to do? She drank that.
The pot liquor. is what we used to call it in the country. I'm a country boy. And it was called the pot liquor because that's where all your nutrients were, you know, greens.
She swore it cleaned her blood. When you drink that asparagus water?
Because it's full of nutrients. All your nutrients. Okay. So that's why the water's so pretty green and because all your nutrients are there. And the vegetables are pretty much, there's nothing there. It's just a shell. But your nutrients are in your liquid.
You know, they used to know what they're doing.
That's right. They didn't live a long time for nothing.
So, okay. Now
as you can see, I'm going to check the tenderness of the vegetables to see where we are. And I think we're just about there to blend this up.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do, I'm going to turn this off, okay?
I'm going to get out of your way here.
I have my right-hand machine here. This is an immersible blender.
Okay.
And the good thing about immersible blenders, you can plug them up and you go right through the stove with this. And this is going to blend up everything, your stems of your thyme and everything. Okay. So I'm going to make a little noise here, okay?
I'm going to need one of those.
And they're really inexpensive. You know, depends on what you're going to use them for. They go from under 20 up to thousands. Like I said, once again, it depends on what you want to use it for. But it's a good machine to have for around the house for making soups and making sauces, blending them up. Now, when you're going to blend up your soups, you know, it's your choice how fine you want to blend them up.
Okay.
Some people like it nice and chunky, some like it coarse, some love it fine. And once again, you know, if you have, adults in the house, even kids that may have swallowing disorders, you know, this is a good way to, this is a good machine to have around the house to soften up your food. So once we're satisfied with the blending, we're also satisfied, if we're satisfied with the thickness of our soup, the consistency
Looks good.
Of it, then we are.
You really did a fine job there.
Thank you. So I'm going to bowl this up so you guys can see what it looks like bowled up.
Beautiful.
And just
you know, that looks like springtime.
And we're just gonna
beautiful color.
A little bit of our microgreens over top, and this just gonna not only just add to the presentation, but also the nutrients. It's gonna just add more nutrients to that particular soup right there. So this you
could actually freeze?
This you can freeze.
Okay, so then what do I put it in freezer bags or container?
If it's a freezer container, you know, I always suggest folks to use freezer bags and make sure that, you know, you seal it really well. And
I just want to make sure people see how pretty this looks and the pretty color.
You don't have to go out and buy vacuum seal machines to actually seal in your foods. A pot of cold water would do the same thing. You take your particular vegetables or whatever you want to freeze, and you're just going to slowly submerge it in that cold water. The pressure is going to push the air out and lock it around your vegetables or fruits, and you seal the end, and in the freezer we go.
Very cool. So I noticed that other than whatever seasoning was in your broth, you didn't add much. I mean, the garlic, of course, has the flavor. The shallots have
exactly.
the flavor.
And that's the beauty
time.
About fixing your own foods, getting in the kitchen cooking. You know, you didn't see me add any salt to this at all.
Right.
You know, the different flavors from the shallots, from the leeks, from the fresh thyme itself, and your broth or your stock that you fix, you know what's in there. That's all the seasons you're going to need.
Yeah.
You know, because we don't want to over season, especially with a lot of salt. So we really want to be careful with that. And the right herbs with the onions and the garlic, you'd be surprised the flavors you can achieve. And you're not even going to miss it at all.
You forgot to bring the spoon. because I wanted to taste it right now because it smells so good.
Thank
and
you
it
so
looks
much.
So pretty.
Thank you so much.
So what a great way to preserve all the nutrients in those fresh spring greens. But I suppose you could do that same thing with broccoli, let's
sure
say,
can.
Make a broccoli soup.
The same recipe that I just done right here, you can do with any vegetable. You're just going to swap out the vegetables. So if you want to do, you know, potatoes, leek, you're just going to do potato leek.
How about greens?
Now, with the greens, I always suggest eating your greens raw.
Okay.
And I've done a lot of demonstrations with multiple greens just chopped up with a little bit of olive oil and with just a little bit of lemon juice and just a little sea salt on it, and I mixed them together. And the flavors are unbelievable because the greens all have their own distinguished flavors, and the combination is wonderful. And you know, when you say raw greens, folks are like, no, I don't think
like
about
kale and collard.
Like kale and collard.
Really?
Until once I introduced them to the raw salads, they were like, wow.
Yeah.
You know, because greens are again one of the ones we overcook, and doesn't take but 4 minutes, and you know, there's no nutrients in those greens. So we might as well just take the leaves and throw away, and once again, we're going to drink the liquid because that's where your nutrients are.
Very good. Chef Herb is one of our Land Grant staff members in the Center for Nutrition, Diet, and Health. And like Chef Herb, many of our faculty and Land Grant specialists conduct research and teach not only in the classrooms, laboratories, and architecture studios on our UDC campuses, but you will find us at community gardens, schools, and farmers markets all over the District of Columbia. If you would like more information about our academic programs, workforce development certificates, workshops, clinics, or soil and water testing services, please visit us at www.udc.edu/causes. Thank you for joining me on Causes, a television series from the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability, and Environmental Sciences of the University of the District of Columbia. I am Sabine O'Hara. See you next time on Causes.